So, in the last video, we saw that the living organisms have various substances inside them, right? And these were the biomolecules which are present in the living organism, right? Now, the best thing about our body is there is constant turnover happening. Turnover means constantly new substances are being formed, right? So, the biomolecules are getting changed from one form to another. All the biochemical reactions taking place inside a living system together constitute metabolism. This is how the biomolecules change from one form to another. So, examples of this would be removal of CO2 from amino acids to form amine, removal of amino group in a nucleotide base, or hydrolysis of a glycosidic bond. There are thousands such reactions occurring in our body, right? So, constantly things are changing in our body from one form to another. This is what forms the metabolism of our body. So, the intermediate products which are made as a result of this metabolic reactions are called metabolites. The flow of metabolites in a metabolic pathway has a definite rate and direction, just like normal automobile traffic. This metabolite flow is called dynamic state of the body constituents. So, based on this metabolism, we have two types of metabolites, primary and secondary. Primary metabolites are those which are essential for life, right? They are necessary for life, like amino acids, sugars, nucleic acids, lipids, all these are essential for life. Then we have secondary metabolites. Now, secondary metabolites are not directly involved in normal growth, development, or reproduction, but they are found in plants, fungal, and microbial cells, like alkaloids, pigments, terpenoids, essential oils, toxins, lectins, drugs, etc. So, the examples are, as we saw before, pigments like carotenoids, anthocyanins, alkaloids like morphine, codeines, terpenoids, essential oils like lemongrass, then there are toxins like abrin, ricin, lectins like canocannabinol A, drugs, polymeric substances like rubber, gum, cellulose, all these form secondary metabolites, right? Now, all of these are linked by a multi-step chemical reaction. That is, one thing is always dependent on another. So, this is what forms the steps to the metabolic pathway. This is how the flow of energy is maintained, right? Now, these metabolic pathways, they can be of two types. They can be anabolic or they can be catabolic. Anabolic pathways are the pathways which consume energy. Anabolic processes are generally constructive processes. So, what is happening here is we take simple molecules, we join them up with the help of energy and we make complex structures, right? So, we use energy over here. Like for example, we change acetic acid to cholesterol, amino acids to proteins to form bigger molecules. Catabolic processes are opposite of anabolic processes. Here, we break down complex molecules into simple structure. These are destructive processes and obviously because they are destructive, they will release energy. Like glucose getting converted to lactic acid by glycolysis, respiration, all these are catabolic processes. Right? The energy released through catabolism is stored in the chemical bonds. So, whenever we require this energy, this bond is broken and this is how we use the energy. In our body, we have a proper energy currency. So, what is this currency? This currency is ATP. ATP is adenosine triphosphate. Three phosphate molecules here are joined with the ribose sugar and adenine to give ATP. Now, we all know that whenever we want to buy anything, we have to give currency or money to the shopkeeper. Similarly, if you want to do something in your body, you have to pay the body. So the body gives the payment in form of ATP. So this is what we call as living state, right? In all organisms, the metabolites are present in different concentration. For example, the blood group concentration of glucose in a normal person might vary from 4.2 to 6.1. The concentration of hormones might be in nanogram. So in this way, it differs from a person to person. So living state is basically non-equilibrium state, non-equilibrium steady state, which is required to be able to perform any work, right? So the systems at equilibrium cannot perform any type of work. Okay, so we need this equilibrium to do any work, right? So we understand that no living state will exist without metabolism. Okay. Now, in order to do all these metabolic reactions, we need something called as enzymes. What are these enzymes? These enzymes are basically biological catalysts. So what they do is they speed up the reactions, right? All enzymes are basically proteins, but not all proteins are enzymes. Like example, keratin, which is found in our hair, is not an enzyme, right? The other properties of enzymes are that they are very specific. For each enzyme, there is a particular substrate. Substrate is the thing on which an enzyme acts, right? So it is like lock and key. For every enzyme, there will be only one substrate on which it acts, right? For example, ribozymes, right? They will only act. They are basically RNA enzymes, that is nucleic acids, which are behaving as enzymes. They form tertiary structure, 3D structure, with some pockets, that is cervices. This is where they bind with the substrate, right? The substrate comes and fits here. So this is called the active site of an enzyme. So in this way, enzymes are very specific and they play an important role in all the biochemical reactions happening in our body by speeding them up. Otherwise, the reactions would be too slow, right? So the chemical compounds undergo basically two types of changes. It can be a physical change where there is a change in shape or state of the matter without breaking bonds, like ice melting and water changing into vapor, right? Or it can be chemical change. Here the bonds are broken and new bonds are formed, right? So it may be organic or inorganic. Like inorganic, where you can see your BaOH twice reacts with sulfuric acid to give us BaSO4 and water molecule is released. Or it can be something like organic, where the starch is hydrolyzed, broken down into glucose. So the rate of physical or chemical processes is the amount of product which is formed per unit time, right? We know this. Now what do the enzymes do? They will lower this rate, right? So rate is called the velocity if the direction is specified. The rates of physical and chemical processes is influenced by factors like temperature. So generally, as we increase temperature, the rate will increase. The rate doubles or decreases by half for every 10 degrees C change in the direction, right? So rate of enzyme catalyzed reactions is very high. Like for example, carbonic anhydrase is the fastest enzyme. It accelerates the following reaction, the conversion of CO2 plus H2O to form H2CO3 about 10 million times. In absence of the enzyme, only 200 molecules of H2CO3 are formed in an hour. In presence, we have 600,000 molecules forming per second. So you understand the difference between the two, right? How enzymes speed up the reactions. Without enzymes, the reactions would be very, very difficult. Now, if we take a metabolic pathway, then in each step, we'll have a different enzyme. Like in glycolysis, we can see there are 10 different enzymes involved, like hexokinase, phosphofructokinase, aldolase. So eventually what is happening in glycolysis, we are getting pyruvic acid from glucose. But each enzyme is different because its substrate is different, right? Let us try and understand the nature of enzyme action. So an enzyme acts on a substrate just like lock and key. Like for every lock, we have a particular key. Here also for every enzyme, we have a particular substrate. So the substrate will go and bind with the enzyme, and we have something called as enzyme substrate complex. This will change and give us something called as enzyme product complex. The active site basically breaks the chemical bonds of the substrate to give us the product. Hence we have the enzyme product complex, right? After this, the enzyme releases the products and the free enzyme is ready to bind to other molecules. So if you notice, during this entire state, the enzyme is remaining unchanged, right? This pathway goes through some unstable transitional state structure. So till now, I've been telling you all that enzyme speeds up the reactions, but how does an enzyme actually speed up the reaction? So first, we need to understand activation energy to understand this. Activation energy is the additional energy which is required to start a chemical reaction, right? It is the minimal energy that I require to do any reaction. In an exothermic or endothermic reaction, the substrate must go through much higher energy state. This is called transition state energy. Therefore, activation energy is the difference between the average energy of substrate and this transition state energy, right? So if the product is at a lower energy level than the substrate, the reaction is an exothermic reaction. It requires no energy because already the product is at lower energy, right? In a biochemical reaction, what enzymes do is they lower this activation energy. You can see here. The activation energy with enzyme is much lower as compared to the activation energy without enzyme. So because they lower this energy, the reactions happen very, very fast, as we saw in the example of carbonic anhydrase. Now, there are various factors which affect the enzyme activity. These are temperature and pH, the concentration of substrate which is present, and the presence of inhibitor. Let us study all these factors. Enzymes show the highest activity at something called as optimum temperature. This is the best temperature and pH at which the enzyme works, right? Below this, the activity will decline. At low temperature, the enzymes are inactive because that there is no energy to bond with the substrate. And if we go to higher temperatures, then the enzymes destroy because we know proteins denature at higher temperatures. So the active site will get destroyed. The substrate will not come and bind here. So that's why the enzymes will be destroyed and they are denatured at higher temperature, right? Inorganic catalysts, they work at high temperature and pressure, but enzymes get denatured at temperature about 40 degrees. Thermophilic organisms have enzymes, however, which are stable at high temperatures like 80 to 90 degrees. So there are special thermophilic bacteria which will possess these enzymes. Now let us study how concentration of substrate affects an enzymatic reaction. So if we increase the substrate concentration, then the velocity of the enzyme action rises at first and then it reaches a maximum velocity. Beyond this point, we cannot exceed because the enzyme molecules are fewer than the substrate molecules now. Right? We can see that no free enzyme is left. So the substrate won't bind. So this is the maximum velocity. So generally, if we increase the substrate concentration, then the rate of the reaction will increase. Another factor that will affect is the presence of inhibitors. The binding of specific inhibitors shuts off the enzyme activity. So this is called inhibition. So this is an enzyme, this is a substrate. If an inhibitor comes and binds here, then the activity will shut down. This is called inhibition. The inhibitor closely similar to the substrate is called competitive inhibitor. You can see here the shape of the substrate and the inhibitor is quite similar. So this is called competitive inhibitor. It actually competes with the substrate for binding site of the enzyme. So there is no place now for the substrate to come and bind because here the inhibitor is already bonded with the enzyme complex, right? So the reaction will not occur. And if the shape of the inhibitor is not the same, then this is called non-competitive inhibition. Right, so let us look at an example of competitive inhibition. Malonate is similar to substrate succinate. So it inhibits succinic dehydrogenase in this reaction, right? So succinic dehydrogenase changes succinate to fumarate. Here, because the inhibitor is of the same shape, it will come and bind and the reaction will not occur. These are also important to us because the competitive inhibitors are used to control all the bacterial pathogens. Now, if we want to classify enzyme, then we can do that based on what they do. So we have oxidoreductases or dehydrogenases, which do oxidation and reduction reaction. Then we have transferases. Transferases will transfer a group of substances. Then we have hydrolases, lysases, isomerases, ligases. We will study about each one of these in detail. As you might have noticed, these enzymes are ending with SES. So oxidoreductases generally catalyze oxidation and reduction reaction between two substrates. A substrate may be reduced or oxidized because of their presence. Then we have transferases, which transfer a group of substances from one place to another. We can see here, if this is the enzyme and this is the substrate, then there is a definite change. That is, first the substrate was AB, now it has become A, and BC is something new which is formed as a result of this reaction. Then we have hydrolases. They catalyze hydrolysis of ester, ether, peptide, glycosidic, CC bond, carbon halide bond. All these bonds, we can see here, this is an example of hydrolases. Then we have lysases. They remove a group by mechanics other than hydrolysis, leaving a double bond. Then we have isomerases. So they catalyze interconversion of optical, geometric or positional isomers. They are called isomerases. Then we have got ligases. Ligases link to compounds, that is, they join things together. So these are all the various types of enzymes, right? Now there is something else called cofactors. Cofactors are basically non-protein constituents which are bound to the enzyme to make the enzyme catalytically active. For example, APO enzyme is like a protein portion of the enzyme. Right? So this is the inactive part and the cofactor will come and join here and make it active. So now we will call it as hello enzyme. When a cofactor is removed from the enzyme, then its catalytic activity is completely lost. So there are various types of cofactors, right? They can be prosthetic group, coenzymes or metal ions. We'll look at each one of this. prosthetic groups are generally organic and tightly bound to the Apo enzyme. Like for example, heme in peroxidase and catalase. They catalyze the breakdown of hydrogen peroxide to water and oxygen. Then we have coenzymes. They are organic, and here there is transient binding to apoenzyme. That is, it is not permanent. Many coenzymes contain vitamins. Example, NADP and NADPH contain niacin. The next one is metallic ions. They form coordination bonds with side chain at an active site and one or more coordination bonds with the substrate. Example, zinc is a cofactor of carboxypeptidase. So with this, we have come to the end of the chapter. I hope you all understood this chapter properly.